Good morning, everybody. How are we doing today? It's good to see a bunch of smiling faces and talkative folks. It's always good to come together as the body of Christ and our family on a Sunday morning. We're going to have a good worship time today. The announcements are the same as last week. Pending weather, of course, as always, because we're in for another round of good snow this week. So Wednesday night, we had our first Bible study with Forgotten God. It was a great conversation, a lot of stuff to think about. We'll have another one this Wednesday if the roads are clear. If not, we'll just push it back to next week again, and that's fine. And then VBS, if you are interested at all in VBS, even if it is like you want to come for a minute on the second day that we have VBS, come and help, and we'll rope you in. You'll stay for the rest of the week, and you'll love it, and it'll be fun. We need a lot of help. We're still getting to the beginning stages of planning, but I can already tell we're going to need a lot of volunteers and support and prayer. And that's what I'm going to ask you again for this morning. Last week I said, start praying for the kids who will be coming to VBS so they could hear the gospel, so they could hear scripture and be transformed from the young age instead of waiting until they're adults and it's harder to make those connections with God. So start praying for those kids now, and then when summer comes, they'll have several months worth of prayer covering them over to get ready for that week of VBS. Sound good?
Amen.
Yes, thank you. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for how great you are. We thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. The best one being your son. And we could talk about different studies and gatherings and times of fellowship and all this, but if we lose sight of Jesus, what's the point? Father, we thank you for your son today. Thank you for sending him to this earth to pay the price for sin that we could not ever pay. Thank you for loving us enough to do that and giving us the grace and the mercy that we didn't deserve and the hope that we can now hold on to as we live in this dark world. Father, be with us in our time of worship today. Help us to focus on you and you alone. We pray this in your son's name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Psalm chapter 63 is a psalm of David, and the title is, My Soul Thirsts for You. O God, you are my God, earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name I will lift up my hands. If you are able, we ask you to stand with us as we sing this morning.
Seen how all thy longings have been.
His goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do. If with His love He befriend thee.
Praise the Lord.
Always, I will not fear His promise. is true. My God will come through always, always.
Oh, my.
Oh, my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always,
Scripture reading this morning is found in Joel 2, 12 and 13. That is why the Lord says, "Turn to me now, while there is time. Give me your hearts. Come with fasting, weeping, and mourning. Don't tear your clothing in your grief, but tear your hearts instead. Return to the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. He is eager to relent and not punish." Father God, we come to you this morning. We've seen revival that is taking place in other parts of the country. Father, we pray for that revival to take place around the world, in this country, in this state, in this area, Father, in this church. We pray for revival in the hearts of these that are here. Father, I pray for revival in my heart. Father, as we wait in anticipation for your return, help us to not sit by and idly wait, but Father, as we wait, as we look up, help us to be found serving you, being light in this country, in this area, in our neighborhoods. Lord, help us to turn our hearts back to you. And we give thee praise this morning. Thank you for the opportunity we have to come together and worship a true God, a living God. And we thank you, God, in Jesus' name.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Go ahead and grab your Bibles for me this morning. Why do we read our Bibles? What's the point in reading our Bibles? Do we read our Bibles just to learn cool little trivia facts? Are we studying for a test that comes at the end of our life? I hope not. I'm not good at tests. Why do we read our Bibles? It's not for learning factoids. We should be reading our Bibles so that we could get to know God. Right? There's no multiple choice test that Paul and Peter are going to hand us before we enter the pearly gates of heaven, saying you must pass this test before we let you in. Specifically between pages 1,142 and 1,312, right? That's what they're going to be testing us on. That's not the case. We've been given this book so that we can know God on a personal level. God has revealed himself through these words that we have written here on these pages so that we can know God. Isn't that incredible? You have the ability to know God by reading this book. Now, oftentimes, the way Jesus teaches us is that he uses pictures and symbols and images and stories. And in John chapter 10, Jesus tells us that he's the good shepherd. In John chapter 6, he tells us that he's the bread of life. In John 15, he portrays himself as the true vine. And in all of these images, we learn about who Jesus is, but also what our relationship with God is like. As the shepherd, Jesus cares for us. As the bread of life, he nourishes us. As the true vine, he supports us and he gives us life. These are images that help us to know who Jesus is and know what a relationship with God is like. Fox News wants to talk right now. But in the book of Luke, we've also seen these images of Jesus as the master of the house. And we've seen it a couple times now. In Luke 12, Jesus tells a parable of how we need to be ready for the master of the house to return. Again, in Luke 14, Jesus tells us that the master of the house has this great banquet feast that he's going to invite everybody to come to. These are all beautiful stories that depict Christ as the owner of the house and all that's in it. But in those stories, there were also people who worked for the master, who were stewards for all that the master had. And that's the idea that we're going to look at this morning and next week, because this idea of stewardship can be seen throughout chapter 16 of the book of Luke. Those who serve God are stewards of his house. Meaning if we've chosen to follow God, to serve God, we are his stewards of all that he has given us. And there are some expectations that come along with that. So if you have your Bibles, open them up to Luke 16. Turn them to chapter 16. We'll be reading verses 1 through 18 this morning. And back in Luke chapter 12, verse 42, Jesus had asked his audience at that time a question. He asked, "Who then is a faithful and wise manager who his master will set over his household to give them their portion of food at the proper time?" And today, we're going to actually see an answer to that question that Jesus posed a few chapters back. So let's go ahead and pray, and we'll jump in to our passage today. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity we have to hold your thoughts in our hands this morning so that we can know who you are, and that's what we desire to do today. Help us to focus on nothing else than you. Block out the distractions from our minds, from our hearts, from the windows, and help us to focus solely on what your word says today. We pray this in your son's name, amen. So we're about to read a parable about two people here. The master of a house, the rich man, and the master, or the manager of the master's affairs, the manager in the story. However, this parable can be difficult to understand. And to tell you the truth this morning, I struggled quite a bit this week studying and preparing this parable. And if we're not careful, it can be easy to misinterpret and misunderstand what we're about to read. At face value, we read about this rich man or this master of the house, and probably immediately we think back to the other two parables that we've read in Luke already, and we think, that must be Jesus. I got it. And some people, some commentators and theologians, they actually would agree and teach it this way, that this rich man is Jesus in the story. However, there are an equal amount of commentators and theologians who don't agree, and they teach that this rich man is not Jesus in this story. So it's not just me that's had a hard time. It's not just us that's going to have a hard time. Everyone's kind of struggling with how to interpret this passage. And as I've studied this passage this week, I've landed on this I don't agree side, and I'll tell you why as we go along, but I wanted to set that up now so that we can begin reading this parable with the hopes of understanding the meaning behind this parable better. Because that's what parables are for, right? Parables are stories that are told with the intention of teaching one main point. And if we start off down the wrong track with misunderstanding what a parable is, then we're also going to misunderstand the lesson that Jesus is trying to teach his disciples here. So let's go ahead and move into the first verse of chapter 16. It says, Jesus told this story to his disciples. There was a certain rich man who had a manager handling his affairs. One day, a report came that the manager was wasting his employer's money. So the employer called him in and said, "What is this I hear about you? Go get your report in order, because you're going to be fired." So Jesus, he introduces the story and these two people, the rich man and the manager who is handling the master's affairs. The manager apparently not been doing his job very well, and he was wasting his employer's money and resources here. The employer, the rich man, finds out, and he calls the manager in, and he says, "What's the deal? I hear you're wasting my money. I'm kind of upset about this. I need you to clean out your desk and give me your final report, because you're done." And immediately we see the manager's self-preservation kick in verse 3. The manager thought to himself and said, "Now what? My boss has fired me. I don't have the strength to dig ditches, and I'm too proud to beg. Ah, I know. I know how to ensure that I'll have plenty of friends who will give me a home when I'm fired." Jesus paints this guy to kind of be out, kind of be like a desk jockey, right? Too weak to work, too proud to panhandle. He apparently has gotten comfortable using the master's wealth to indulge his appetites personally. And listen, I can kind of commiserate with this guy. 10 years ago, I left working for my dad's company, his moving company, and I left the household and commercial moving company for a cushy desk job. Working with my dad was tough. It was 15 to 16 hours a day, 6 days a week, moving people's stuff back and forth, moving desks and refrigerators, books and washers and dryers and couches and tables up and down stairs all day long. It was exhausting work. But then I got a job working as a social media manager for Dr. Dobson, and I went from walking 10 to 12,000 steps a day, heavy steps a day, to sitting behind a desk for 9 hours a day, It was kind of a nice change of pace there. Kind of a nice cushy job. It didn't take long for me to get used to that desk life. But I remember after about 2 years of working at the desk, my dad called me one afternoon and said, "I have a job on Saturday. Did you want to come up and make a couple $100 and work with me for a day?" And I thought, sure, who wouldn't want a couple $100 in their pocket after one day's of work, right? Let me tell you something, though. I forgot how to use certain muscles in my body after just 2 years. Because that night, I hurt. And the memories of that pain still haunt me to this day. I hurt everywhere. So I kind of get it when this manager says, "I can't go back to work." And I'm way too proud to go on the street and start panhandling. I can't beg people. So I can connect with that. So what does this man come up with instead? He decides to use his last bit of time in his current position to make his transition as easy as possible. He used his position to help secure his future at the expense of the rich man by discounting all the outstanding accounts and the debts that were still owed to the master. Look at verse 5. So he invited each person who owed money to his employer to come and discuss the situation. He asked the first one, "How much do you owe him?" The man replied, "I owe him 800 gallons of olive oil." So the manager told him, "Take the bill and quickly change it to 400 gallons. "And how much do you owe my employer?" he asked the next man. "I owe him 1,000 bushels of wheat," was the reply. "Here," the manager said, "take the bill and change it to 800 bushels. And I can't help but notice, after what we talked about last week, that the manager didn't repent to the rich man. In fact, his initial reaction when he knew that he had gotten caught wasn't repentance, and it wasn't even the slightest bit of remorse for his actions here. This man was truly a crooked man, as crooked as they come. But look, he was also called clever by the world's standards. Look at verse 8. The rich man had to admire the dishonest rascal for being so shrewd. And it's true that the children of this world are more shrewd in dealing with the world around them than are the children of the light. It's surprising to me that the rich man didn't become angry. He doesn't even look to punish his soon-to-be-fired manager. He actually admires the dishonesty and the shrewdness of the manager, right? What's going on? And verse 8 is where this parable can become confusing, especially if we had gone down into this parable with the understanding that Jesus was the rich man, right? What a shocking statement this rich man makes towards the manager. Because essentially what he's saying here is, well done. You got me. Smart move. You did well. I've taught you well. And according to the worldly principles of self-preservation and looking out for number one, it does seem like he did pretty well at his job, right? He took care of himself for the next steps in his life. We read in Psalm 49 that the natural tendency of wicked people is to admire the craftiness of other wicked people. And that's what we see here, isn't it? With the rich man. We see a worldly man commend his worldly manager for his worldly wisdom according to his worldly dealings. Do we see anything like this happening in our culture today? And again, at face value, if we were to understand this parable with the idea of the rich man representing Jesus, we'd be pretty confused at this point, right? Why would Jesus commend this worldly man in his worldly ways of dealing in dishonesty? The answer is he wouldn't, right? And he didn't hear. The lesson of this parable isn't the commending of the dishonest manager's crooked dealings, but rather Jesus wanted to point us towards the idea of his foresight. Look at verse 9. Jesus says, here's the lesson. And Jesus doesn't typically explain his parables immediately after sharing them, does he? But he does here. He says, here's the lesson. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Then your possessions, when your possessions are gone, they will welcome you to an eternal home. You see, the rich man, he praised the dishonest manager because the children of this age are more shrewd than the children of the light when it comes to the way of dealing with the world. In general, non-Christians and non-believers are better and wiser at worldly doings than Christians are. And that should be the case, right? The world should be better at being the world than Christians are at being the world. So when Jesus says this, he's making sure to tell his disciples that he's not praising the manager. That they shouldn't be encouraged to mimic the manager in their worldliness and their evil and deceit. Instead, the lesson that Jesus is telling us here is this. It would be a good idea for you to manage your resources and be shrewd in the things that you steward. Be smart in how you manage your resources. Jesus isn't saying to his disciples to go and be honest. He's saying, think about what's to come. Be smart and savvy with what has been given to you now, not for worldly gain, not so that you can become a rich, powerful ruler in this world, but for spiritual gain in eternity. The manager was an illustration to show that even the most wicked people of this world are shrewd enough to provide for their long-term needs. As so, believers should also be shrewd because we are concerned not with worldly matters, but with eternal matters. And Jesus calls these things the true riches, and we'll see that in a few verses. We are to be concerned with our true riches, our eternal matters. Essentially, what Jesus is saying here is this. He's telling us to use our material wealth that we've been given now and use it to store up treasures in heaven, because those are what really matter. We should be wise in the way we use our money now. We should use it in a way that furthers the kingdom of God, ways that shine Christ's light into the darkness of this world, ways to win souls for Christ, things that have the impact in their eternal setting. As Christians, we've been made stewards of material things in this world. This means we are not owners of anything that we have. We are managers of what we have, responsible to God for how we manage his goods, not ours. And that could be a hard concept to understand for some of us. It could be a hard concept to accept as well. But if Jesus is your Savior and your Lord, we understand two things. We understand that he gave his life for ours. He saved us from the punishment of sin, which was death. But we also understand that by accepting Jesus as Lord, everything we have, all of our stuff, it's all his. He owns it all, and we're merely the managers, the caretakers, and the stewards of what he has given us. So the lesson that we need to learn from this parable is this. God owns everything we have. And we need to be smart stewards of what he's given us to manage as we further progress his kingdom. Our livelihoods, our bank accounts, our cows, our chickens, our horses, our vehicles, our tractors, our land, our homes, our food, our clothes, our relationships, our loved ones. I could go on, right? But we are managers of these things. And if we're managing or stewarding God's things, we need to be faithful in that stewardship. Look at verse 10. Jesus goes on and says, if you are faithful in the little things, you will be faithful in large ones. But if you are dishonest in little things, you won't be honest with great responsibilities. And if you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with their true riches in heaven? And if you are not faithful with other people's things, why should you be trusted with the things of your own? And at this point, Jesus is still talking to his disciples, and he shares these two principles about how we are to serve as stewards. First is the principle of faithfulness. He who is faithful in little things can be trusted with many more larger things. We must be honest and have integrity with the temporal things like money, like land, like possessions if we want to be trusted with more important spiritual matters. This is a common lesson that we teach our children all the time as they grow up. You don't give your kid a responsibility of the entire ranch the second they show interest in wanting a pet cow or a pet dog or a pet frog. Right? You start small until they show they're capable for caring of something small. And then we build on top of that. And once they've proven they're responsible with little, you increase their responsibility with more. Similarly, we can tell the difference between a faithful steward and a dishonest and untrustworthy person by the amount of care they give to the little things. You're not going to give control to your family's resources to a person who's proven to max out 15 or 16 credit cards and has an addiction to online shopping. You're not going to give them all of your financial information to take care of your money, are you? I hope not. It's not a matter of ability that Jesus is speaking of. It's a matter of character. That's why he uses terms faithful and untrustworthy here. It's the character of a person that separates them from being a good steward or a bad one. Jesus doesn't say in verse 10, the unskilled in little. He says the dishonest, the untrustworthy in little. Right? When we as disciples, when we fail to be good stewards, it's like promising God to take care of his things and then simply not doing that. Just like the dishonest manager in the parable. If we are to be faithful to God in little things now, we're told we will be trusted with true riches in heaven in eternity. And that leads us to the second principle. It's impossible to serve two masters. Look at verse 13. It says, no one can serve two masters. For you will hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money. Again, it's impossible to serve two masters. Jesus was laying out a decision that we all need to make here. Are you going to serve the false god of money and possessions, which is idolatry? Or are you going to serve God, who is the owner of all things? Because we can't be devoted to both. Being devoted to one, Jesus says, means that you hate the other. We can either choose to be devoted to the worship of money, or we can be devoted to the worship of God. It cannot be both. And you could take money out and put anything else in there. You could be devoted to the love of your work, or you could be devoted to the love of God. You could be devoted to your relationships, or you could be devoted to God. Jesus says you cannot be devoted to both money and God. And that seems like a lesson that our friends, the Pharisees, would just love to hear, right? No, not at all. Let's read verse 14. The Pharisees, who dearly loved their money, heard all of this and scoffed at him. Yeah, they didn't like that message from Jesus too much, did they? Luke makes it clear to point out that they dearly loved their money. And when Jesus said this, these religious, ultra-pious, God-fearing men needed to choose between God and money. And that wasn't a message they were ready to hear. It wasn't one they ever wanted to hear, because money was their master, not God. They were devoted to their riches and possessions and not following God. So when they heard this teaching about stewardship, even though Jesus wasn't quite talking to them, they were probably over here in the corner eavesdropping in on the conversation, they still couldn't help but reject it and laugh at Jesus. So look at how Jesus responds in verse 15. Then he said to them, "You like to appear righteous in public, but God knows your heart. What this world honors is detestable in the sight of God. Until John the Baptist, the law of Moses and the messages of the prophets were your guides, but now the good news of the kingdom of God is preached, and everyone is eager to get in. But that doesn't mean that the law has lost its force. It's easier for heaven and earth to disappear than for the smallest point of God's law to be overturned. For example, a man who divorces his wife and marries someone else commits adultery. And anyone who marries a woman divorced from her husband commits adultery." There are four things that we're going to look at in these verses here that Jesus tells the Pharisees. First of all, he says, God cannot be fooled. You cannot fool God. The Pharisees were very good at convincing people that they were holy, that they were the chosen people of God, right? They were good at convincing that they were the ones who were truly obeying God. They were so good at convincing people, they even convinced people to take on their yoke and their traditions that weren't even found in Scripture, but because they were the chosen people of God, they convinced people to follow along with them. They even reached a point where they convinced themselves of their own hype. But here's the difference. 1 Samuel 16:7 says, "Humans do not see what the Lord sees. For humans see what is visible, but the Lord sees the heart." The Pharisees, they could fool all you guys. They could fool me. They could fool man. But they couldn't fool God, because God can see their hearts. God knew the Pharisees' heart. God knows your heart. God knows my heart. And we could put up these fronts and these filters. We could put on the masks and pretend to be something that we aren't. And we often do. But that won't ever fool God. And what's striking with this verse, this phrase in verse 15, is how often you hear people saying, "God knows my heart." And they use that as a way of excusing their sin. It's a way of saying, God will be okay with my sin because he understands and he accepts me because he knows my heart is good. But what Jesus is talking about here, when he says that God knows our hearts, it's to make it plain and clear that we cannot fool God. He sees our motives, our thoughts, our desires, and our feelings, and everything else. And truly, when we read that God knows our hearts, we should all be trembling in fear. We may be able to fool ourselves and others, but we will never be able to fool God. The second thing that Jesus says to his Pharisees here is God doesn't love what you love. I often make the mistake that I think that Karen loves to talk about college football as much as I do. Thankfully, she's a great wife, and she listens to me talking about recruiting and spring games that are coming up and summer camps and the upcoming season and how Oklahoma's going into the SEC in a few years, and she acts like she cares about it, but I know she doesn't. We tend to think that others love what we love. But that's a mistake that we should never make with God. Isaiah 55:8-9 tells us that God's ways and thoughts are not like ours. His thoughts and his ways are higher than ours. And if we love something like the way the Pharisees loved their money to the point that it's become an equal with God, then it's become an idol. If we love sports, if we love food, if we love politics and government, if we love our jobs, if we love this building, if we love fill in the blank, and we equate it on the same level of God, those things have become idols in our lives. Caring about those things is not wrong. Enjoying those things is not wrong. But when those things are put on that equal level of God, it's an issue. And it's only when we worship those things, when we worship our possessions, our idols, that it becomes an issue. And that's what the Pharisees were doing with their money. Money had become their idol. And Jesus says, whenever we honor these things, whenever we exalt these things before God, they become detestable in the sight of God. They're not just bad, they are detestable. God hates idols. He is a jealous God. He alone is worthy of all the praise that we could ever give and ever should give. God does not love what you love. The third thing Jesus tells the Pharisees is this: that God's commands are still God's commands. The Pharisees preferred their own way of life, a life based on their love of money. They rejected Jesus' teachings of stewardship, and by doing so, they were rejecting the commands of God. And that's why Jesus said what he said in verse 16 and 17. So let's look at those again real quick. Until John the Baptist, meaning until the beginning of the new covenant, the law of Moses and the messages of the prophets, everything in the Old Testament, those things were your guide. But now the good news of the kingdom of God is preached. Now Jesus has come, the new covenant is here, and everyone is eager to hear it. Everyone is eager to get in. They want to hear the new covenant. But this is a big but in the Bible, but that doesn't mean the law has lost its force. You see, nothing God has ever said or written in his word has an expiration date. There is no command that God has ever given to us that has the word void written across it like a canceled check. God's word continues today with the same force and the same power it had when he first gave it to people. Christ has fulfilled the law, but that doesn't give us the free license to think that the Old Testament doesn't apply to our lives anymore. Or that something from the New Testament times doesn't work with our culture today, then we shouldn't have to obey what the New Testament says. That's not the case. That's a terrible way of thinking about Scripture, about how God has commanded us to get to know him better. God's commands then are God's commands now. And they will continue to be God's commands into the future until Christ returns. God's commands must be obeyed. And that's the fourth thing that Jesus told the Pharisees here. The law was not what the Pharisees thought it was. And as an example, Jesus brings up this topic of divorce, and Jesus challenges the Pharisees' views on divorce. And this topic seems to come out of nowhere. How does Jesus go from discussing stewardship and possessions and then jumps to the topic of adultery and divorce? But I want you to think about where your thoughts have gone this morning while we've read this passage of stewardship. Chances are at the mention of stewardship, you begin to immediately think about your own money, your own spending decisions. And if you did that, then there's a good chance that you began to think not just about yourself, but about your family and their needs and their desires. And if you haven't until now, I just put those thoughts in your head, so you are thinking about them now. So eventually your mind is focused on your relationships, and here Jesus calls into your mind the most intimate and fundamental relationship of all, marriage. You see, Jesus views marriage and the relationship of marriage as stewardship, and how we manage or care for that relationship matters to God. So in the context of obedient stewardship as required by God's word, it makes sense to me that Jesus would speak against adultery to the religious people who believe that you could get a divorce for just about any reason possible. There were some rabbis in ancient Judaism that supported this idea of divorce for offenses as minor as a wife burning her husband's food in the afternoon. You cook a bad meal, divorce. We'll allow it. There are other rabbis who granted divorce for a change in physical appearance of a wife. Thanksgiving rolls around, we put on a couple extra pounds because that dinner was so good. Divorce. We'll allow it. Sinful humanity has had a very low view of marriage from the time of Adam blaming Eve for the fruit. And now our day where we have no-fault divorce, right? So Jesus speaks into that culture to remind us that we need to not only steward our possessions well, but also we need to steward our relationships well. Because even though we live in a fallen world where marriages end for all sorts of reasons, God has always intended marriage to be a lifelong covenant. He intended for man and woman to steward the relationship of marriage until the end of their lives. The same way that Christ cares for his bride, the church, until the end of time. We can't fool God. We can't think God loves what we love. God's word will stand forever. And as Christians, as disciples, as stewards, we must obey God's word. Amen? So what? What can we take from this passage to apply to our lives this week? And I want you to consider this issue of stewardship. Are you a faithful steward of what God has given you to care for? Or are you managing what God has given you for worldly gain, like the manager in the parable? We live in a country that has been blessed beyond belief, right? I mean, honestly, even our worst days are still better than 95% of the world's best days. God has given us so much to be thankful for, and He's given us a lot to be stewards of. So are you truly being a faithful steward? Perhaps there's an area in your life where you need to focus on being a better steward of what God has given you. Maybe it is with your finances. Maybe it's with your time. Maybe it's with your family or your spouse. Maybe it's your prayer life. Your prayer life might be lacking, or your quiet times, the time you get to spend by yourself, not for a study, but just between you and God reading your word. Maybe there's another area in your life that the Spirit's poking at you right now that I've not mentioned, but you know what He is. Surrender your sense of ownership to that thing. It's not yours. It's God's. And ask the Spirit to guide you in the steps that you need to take to be a faithful steward in that area. What else? So what else? Perhaps there's an area in your life where you trick others into thinking you're more religious than you actually are. Some of us are pretty good at fooling others. Are you one of those people? You can choose to continue to live your life fooling everyone else around you, but know that you're never fooling God, because God knows your heart. Surrender that facade to God and ask the Spirit to guide you in the steps that you need to take to be a faithful steward in that area of your life. And there's one more so what that we need to look at. It's idols. We all have them. Whether you're willing to admit it or not, it's not my concern, but remember, God knows your heart. Is there something in your life that you have either intentionally or unintentionally put on a pedestal that has begun to be raised into equality with Jesus? Surrender that idol to God. Ask the Spirit to guide you in steps that you need to take to be a faithful steward in that area of your life. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for this parable, that we are able to understand it. Thank you for the lesson that we gain from this of being a faithful steward. Not preparing ourselves for tomorrow or the next day, but Father, preparing ourselves for the coming day where we get to spend eternity in your presence. Father, help us to surrender the ownership over these issues in our lives that you've pointed out to us today. Father, send your Spirit into our lives right now to work on these areas, to fix our ships, to correct our paths so that we can be faithful stewards of what you have given us. We love you. We worship you today. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Join us in singing Family of God.